The Lion King is one of the most popular films in history, earning $756 million worldwide. Disney surprised many when it selected avant-garde director Julie Taymor to take its blockbuster hit to Broadway. Her experimental designs and puppetry have earned her such monikers as the Shaman of Stagecraft and the Master of Magical Realism. The Lion King musical debuted last month to sold-out audiences and exceptional reviews. Variety magazine calls it a theatrical achievement unrivaled in its beauty, brains, and ingenuity. Here's a look at what they're talking about. Joining me now, the guiding force behind the vision, Julie Taymor. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Are you surprised they chose you to do this?
I was.
Not because you're great talent, but because they're taking a risk on creating, believing this is doable.
What surprised me originally was that they really didn't have to do this. They didn't have to do it to get a box office hit, I don't think. I think that people would have seen The Lion King, someone would have done a good job, but they wanted to do something more than that. They just didn't want a box office hit. They wanted something very creative. They wanted the art. They wanted something to break the boundaries theatrically. And quite honestly, what they tell me, what Tom, because they, to me, is about two or three people at Disney. When people say Disney, I hate that word, you know. It's not that I hate Disney. I just, the concept that it's this big corporation talking to me, it's Tom Schumacher is the man I spoke to.
And who else is it? Two or three people are?
Yes, Peter Schneider, Michael Eisner, and then there are other people who are working there, but those are the main people. And those are the people who I deal with on an artistic level and bring forward my ideas to, and they respond and say yay or nay, and a lot of yay.
Yeah.
But they didn't know how to do it. I mean, quite honestly, Tom knew my work from 10 years prior. He was the head of the Olympic Arts Festival in L.A., and I had done a musical called Liberties Taken with Elliot Goldenthal, my partner, and David Seasdorf, and he'd seen video clips and wanted to bring it to L.A. At the time, it was a big musical, it's like the revolution, but the body side, the underbelly of the American Revolution. There are no historical figures in it. And I did this piece with 15 performers playing 400 roles, talking ships, figureheads, hobby horses that came alive. It was 15 actors playing 10 to 15 roles each, every kind of puppet and mask and live actor. So he'd seen my work in epic form. I'd done the Haggadah with Elizabeth Suedos at the Public. That's the Ten Plagues and the Red Sea. And Juan Darien, which you know is a piece that is a transformation myth about a jaguar that becomes human and then transforms back into a jaguar. The kinds of material that I have dealt with, mythic material, large-scale epic material, magic flute. These are the same kinds of subject matters, source material, that is akin to Disney. Now, the fact that I have a very different aesthetic and way of doing it that is the major difference. But it wasn't that big a shock on the material.
Yeah. Is it something that you thought about doing before Disney said, do it?
The Lion King?
Yeah.
No. No, I never saw it. I hadn't seen the movie.
But you must have known about it.
No, but I wouldn't have thought about it.
Yeah.
And quite honestly, the idea of doing a Disney project, a musical, hadn't really occurred to me. I'll tell you what I wanted to do.
Okay.
Was when I knew that the New Amsterdam was being taken over by Disney, the very first production that had been done there was A Midsummer Night's Dream. And each time it reopened, it was A Midsummer Night's Dream, you know, the famous productions. And then the Max Reinhardt movie was premiered there. And I thought, well, I'm just going to call them up and say, when you reopen the New Amsterdam, I want to do the first show, and it should be in the Midsummer Night's Dream. So that was ironic that I got to open it with another show, but not The Lion King. I didn't think about it.
Just let me take a little tangent here. Tell me about how you got so smart about these kind of things. And I mean, what was the curve for you that led you here?
I think my time in Asia.
Really?
Yes.
4 years?
4 years in Indonesia. I've been
studying
in the theater.
Studying puppetry?
Well, no, not exactly. I had been an actress starting very young, like maybe 11 years old. My mother will say some other age, but I don't know. And I started young and I performed, and this was during the 60s, where there was the influence of Grotowski, the influence of the open theater, the bread and puppet. Actors were creating their own pieces. It wasn't a book. It wasn't about a play. You do a play, you play a role. I had started very young in the theater creating my own work, being a part of my work would be designing, directing, acting. So even at age 14, when I was in Theater Workshop of Boston with Julie Portman and Barbara Lyndon in the basement of the Arlington Street Church, I had started what really now amounts to being a playmaker, a theater maker,
right,
where I get involved not just in one aspect, but in more than one aspect. I see the production from all sides. I don't necessarily write the words, but I work with playwrights, or I work with the wordsmith, or the composer. So I get involved totally. I went to Le Coq in Paris and studied mime when I was 16 for a year, and I was introduced to puppetry and the power of the mask at Le Coq. I was more interested in what the masks could do than I was in just pure mime.
What do you mean by the power of the mask?
Well, Le Coq would use masks as a learning device. He wouldn't use it as an end in and of itself. He would use it as a means to understand movement in the body. So there would be different kinds of masks, not only character masks, which we're all familiar with, but abstract masks. And I saw how you could make the body become an abstraction physically. We would use objects and make them into puppets. This glass of water, what is the personality of the water? You start to look at the movement of how this, and you get it into your body, and that might influence you as a performer. Think of your body as a water in the glass. I mean, this sounds so old now, but when I was 16, because that's how old I was, this was a new world for me to use my body. I wanted real discipline. I'd come out of Theater Workshop of Boston, and I wanted to study theater in a very disciplined manner. And I was turned on to masks, puppets, clowning at Le Coq.
Yeah.
And after that, I worked with Herbert Blau. I don't know if you're familiar with Herb Blau, but he was the head of Lincoln Center with Jules Irving, and then went out to Cal Arts. And Bill Irwin,
right.
Sharon Ott,
right.
David Seesdorf, we were all part of the Oberlin Group at Oberlin, where we created theater from scratch. We created theater from a concept. The first piece we did was The Seeds of Atreus, which was actually not from scratch. It was based on the Oresteia, like a 50-minute Oresteia. Mm-hmm. Bill was Orestes, I was Electra. I did the costumes at that time, completely untrained. It's just that I've always worked with my hands, painting or sculpting, so the mass and puppetry is a logical combination of theater and the plastic arts for me. It's a great place for me to put both of those talents. And with Herb, it was an extraordinary experience in how to become verbal, how to create theater out of books, letters. We did the Donner Party for a year.
Yeah.
We worked on the Donner Party, its crossing. Seven of us in a gym, isolated in Oberlin, Ohio, not much else to do but work on this piece. And it was a tremendous training ground.
But when you weigh all of that, it was Indonesia.
Then after that was Indonesia. Indonesia, I went for 3 months and stayed 4 years.
Because? You were learning so much and you
Yes, because I had never been to a place where theater was functioning in its original mode.
Yeah.
And theater was not about, you know, you've probably heard this before, but there's no word for artist in Bali. It's what you do. It's a way of life. The people, I started a theater company there after 2 years, of Javanese, Balinese, Sundanese, a Frenchman, an Englishman, and myself, and a German. And the people in my company from Bali, for instance, were farmers or tailors or school teachers and great dancers. And it's just, it was extraordinary to me. I was 22 years old to be in a place, I've been doing theater for 11 years, so I wasn't new to theater, but to be in a place where theater was an educational, religious tool, political. It was there as the great dating game. I mean, you go to the theater, you go to a 9-hour shadow play in Java or Bali to flirt, to eat, to see a story which you may know very well, like The Lion King. Because this later I'd love to tell you how I've been observing how The Lion King is functioning really for these audiences in much the way the Mahabharata might function in India, or a Greek play might have functioned in ancient Greece.
Tell me now, then.
Okay, tell you now. The whole, I had studied shamanism, and the way that I came to study theater at Oberlin, and both intellectually and as a practitioner, is to study theater as a ritual event. Why do we do it? Why did it come up? And the act of a family or a community or a village putting on a play with a shaman, or a shaman divining an event, who's the shaman is the original theatrical performer, the first artist, performing artist, is really to reaffirm for the community or family or whatever, to reaffirm their place within the structure, within their society.
And therefore Lion King.
Lion King being such a familiar piece of storytelling. Everybody, most of the people seeing the movie, when they come with their family and they sit down to watch something they already know.
They know some of the story.
They know the story. Besides which, the story is about your place in society. The power of The Lion King, the movie, which is the same as in the play, is about that circle of life. Is about saying you may have something that takes you far away from home. You may fall apart your family. You may be from a single parent family. You may have had a death in the family, but you know you can always go home again. Not only can you go home, but you must. That you must pick up the mantle, that you have a responsibility to a community outside of yourself. And in America, where everybody's so divided, where people feel like they're not connected, this sings very strongly to the family, to the individual. So now you come with your family and you say, we know this story. This is like going to Passover, you know, the ritual that happens. Now we're going to enjoy how these particular theater artists tell it in a fresh way. And you're very aware when you go into the New Amsterdam Theater of the audience around you.
All right. Take me now to what were the marching instructions from Disney? Now that we know how brilliant you are, in a sense, no, I'm serious, that's me, not you. Now that we know, and what were their marching instructions? Because they're going to give you a bunch of money to go mount a big deal production.
Yes.
So what did they say?
In the beginning, almost nothing, which was both your kind of positive and negative experience, because I knew that Michael Eisner wanted a Broadway show. He wanted a legitimate Broadway musical. On the other hand, people were saying, we're not sure whether, Tom said, I'm not sure it is one. Maybe it's a Radio City Music, maybe it's a Cirque du Soleil, maybe it's a, you know, let's put it into a planetarium.
Yeah.
Should it be environmental? We want this, but go away now for 3 months, come up with a concept. How do we make this into a musical? I said, well, you know, I think that the story needs work. Can I work on the script? Yes, work on the script. Well, are there any guidelines? Not yet. Now, there were none in the beginning. And in a way, I think that was wonderful, because what it did was it opened me up to the possibilities of anything. And I came up, I struggled very hard in the beginning with, how am I going to do a two and a half hour musical with just animals? What am I going to do when the power of the movie is about the human? It's about the humanity coming through those animals. What am I going to do? How can I do this? So I actually went way off the mark for a little bit and wrote a second act storyline that had new characters, new places, half human, half animal creatures. And when I presented that, No, that was too far. No, that was unnecessary. But what that did was it really made me have to search harder for how to create the human and the animal within the within the limitations of the movie environment itself.
Because the movie was animation. And so all of a sudden, what your challenge is to give it both dimensions on stage.
I wanted to make it, the biggest thing for me, which I said to them and they said to me, was I want it to be so theatrical. I don't want this to have anything to do with movie. So I'm going to really try and keep projections out of it as much. I'm going to make it as visceral as possible. I'm going to bring it into the house. Mm. I want to use the boxes. I want the stage space to surround the audience.
Right.
And the big attraction for me was the possibility of high-tech, low-tech. What I mean by that is, with the money, I get to experiment. I get to play and design with my phenomenal collaborators like Richard Hudson, the set designer, Michael Curry, my puppet and mask co-designer. We get to really go for what our imaginations, whatever we think of. On the other hand, where I come from, which is poor theater, and well, poor and not so poor. I mean, it gets richer and richer as it goes along,
and
more
really
and more expensive.
Really in the hot cotton now.
But it doesn't make me stop using the things that I've done well that are simple means,
right.
Simple things like the tears coming out, or the water that dries up, things that don't cost any money, or the shadow plays. That's what people wanted from me. That's what Disney wanted. They wanted some of that kind of pure theater, which is very ancient techniques that I've readapted and recreated.
So where did anything other than the second act idea that came and went
yes.
real fast, was anything else?
No, and then really the heart of what I had done in the second act, which was to strengthen Simba's story,
right.
that we then went back to the drawing board, and with the writers, Irene Mecchi and Roger Allers, we reworked the script.
Right. Anything you really wanted to do that Disney said no?
No, not after that initial try with the script.
Okay, they said no to that, and you were okay. But you got it made a difference anyway. How many changes took place between Minneapolis and Amsterdam?
Amsterdam, yes, good. New Amsterdam.
Right.
Very little. Mostly 5 minutes, 5 to 7 minutes, that's it.
Early audience didn't tell you anything?
First preview was the most, in Minneapolis,
right.
was as spectacular as anything. I mean, we weren't finished. We had a big gap there. We had a scene change problem. Eventually, what happened, Tom and Peter would get up in the first preview, and they go, all right, now we're going to take a pause for 10 minutes. We had an organized pause. We just weren't ready to do the stampede change.
Yeah.
So Roger and Irene went off and wrote the most marvelous scene between Zazu and Mufasa, which now when we think about it isn't filler at all, but very, very, it's a wonderful scene, a character scene, that if it wasn't there, we'd be worse off as a
Do you have a character, let's assume not Simba, okay,
mm-hmm.
that you love?
Yes, Rafiki.
Really?
Yes.
Why?
Well, if you know, Rafiki in the movie was the baboon,
right.
and was played by Robert Guillaume, the voice of Robert
right.
Guillaume. It was a male character, was a kind of shaman character,
right.
but very comic. She still is comic, but I had said, I was very unhappy, as many females and other people would be, with the fact that there wasn't a great adult female character in The Lion King in the movie. So I very early on wanted
Sad.
To... What?
Said.
I said, well, it's an odd story and a long story, so I will only tell it if you have time,
okay.
how I came to Rafiki being female. But basically, I had this idea inspired by a South African actress who was laughing at me for the lack of a character for her to play in the film, in the Broadway musical. And I got the notion that if there was any character that could be female, it could be Rafiki. And it would be wonderful to have a woman do not only a comic role, but a comic spiritual role, a comic role with weight. It's very rare in almost any culture for that to happen. Almost any. The women are, if you're a comic, you're a lowbrow comic. If you're spiritual, then you have queenliness about you and you have dignity, but you can't get it wrapped up in one thing like
right.
the males can. So we knew that you wanted a female voice singing The Circle of Life. Well, who is that character? So by making it the outsider, the actress playing Rafiki would sing one of the great songs and would have that distance which Rafiki has by being the outsider. And then when Sidi Laloka came, when I cast this fabulous South African actress, I improvised with her. She speaks Xhosa, her own language. We got to develop things with her that weren't even in the original film or script. And I love that character. I think she's tremendous, and I also like the character.
Talk to me about the audience briefly in terms of first African Americans seeing all of these on this great hit, all of these black faces.
Well, I think that Lion King is one of the few predominantly non-white, I mean, we have all kinds of colors up on stage, but non-white musicals, it's not about race. Yet, everything on that stage is about race. What I mean by that? It's not about racism. It's not about racial issues. Yet the beauty up on that stage is everything about the power of the race that's on that stage, whether it be the few white guys, and there are, and they're terrific, but predominantly the African-American and African performers up there. And the power of Africa through Lebo M's contribution. He's the South African composer who worked with Hans Zimmer on the original score and Mark Mancina for the movie. It was all his chorus. And it was his chorus and his songs and his participation that made me the most excited musically. That's really what hooked me in. Rhythm of the Pride Lands, the album.
What do you mean, hooked you in?
Hooked me in when I thought, look, there are five songs in the original musical, Elton Elton John and Tim Rice songs, and they're excellent songs, but you're doing a musical. You need 10 more, 12, 13 more songs. Where are they going to come from? There was another album called Rhythm of the Pride Lands, which came out subsequent to the Lion King album, and it was songs in Zulu, some in English, but were inspired by the original score music. Chris Montan, the music people at Disney said, we own these, we can use these. I took this album, remember One by One, the intermission where the birds are all going around? Who cares? What they're actually singing is wonderful lyrics, but I'd rather you didn't understand it.
Two questions near the end. One, and also about children.
Okay.
How do they react, and how are they different from adults, and do they see it differently?
Well, I haven't interviewed children, but I know that they sit there. They see it. I direct Shakespeare.
Right.
To me, it's the same. You hook in at whatever level you can hook in. If they get it because they get the simple line of the story, they get the color, the music, they may not understand to appreciate the abstraction on the same level as the adults do, but they know that these white lines are tears. They know what they're seeing. They can compute and understand.
What does the success of Lion King? Peter Stone was here earlier, walked out and said, something you like, it's going to run forever. I'm not sure what he said. Something like that.
Yes, he did. Yeah. Well, I think it's great that this is the first introduction to theater for children.
Okay. What does the success of Lion King, will it have an impact beyond its own success?
I think so.
In what way?
I am in theater now because I saw theater up at Stratford, A Midsummer Night's Dream, when I was 7. You know, it was a huge event for me to see theater. If you're going to get this huge audience of young people seeing this kind of theater for the first time, and it's meaningful to them, they will create. They will understand the power of live theater over what film or television can do better. Because what you're seeing up there, not that it wouldn't look good on video, it does, but it is purely theatrical, a purely theatrical form. So I think that there's going to be a renewed interest in the art of puppetry, in the power of the mask, the actors, you know, this combination. It's a new form for
it's
people.
All over Broadway, people are saying, let's do Lion King.
Well, they can't do that so easily.
Secondly, what does it mean for you? Tell me about the sheer, at the emotional, personal level, to see this come to fruition with all the power it has.
It's totally gratifying. It's gratifying for what the audiences are feeling, but it's also gratifying that people can see that an artist can be extremely true to their art and make a buck for their bosses or for themselves. It's just fantastic that people are acknowledging that commerce doesn't mean that you have to throw out. That's schlock. You can aspire to the highest, and you can make it happen, and people will pay for it. Which means, you know, for a long time I've been doing a lot of shows that people love, but everybody goes, well, we're not so sure it's
commercial.
It's not going
to work.
But, you know, here you say, well, this is very experimental.
But then why is that? Because of the themes, because of the music, because of it's an
why is it working? What do you mean?
In other words, why does quality work here?
I think that The Lion King worked as a movie. You said it. It did. So there's something inherently great
in the story
and in the power of the music. There's two things there. Then you couple that with an original way of telling the story, and people, they're hungry, they're thirsty, they want to be surprised. They want what circus gives you. They want that feeling right. of liveness. And most theater, you could put a video camera on, and it would be better, really. The close-ups would make it more personal. You'd rather see it on a film.
What do you do next?
Well, I'm going to shoot a film of Titus Andronicus.
Oh, a film?
A film, feature film. And I have three or four feature films, and Elliot Goldenthal, who's my collaborator, and I are working on an opera of Grendel. Do you know the John Gardner
yeah,
novel?
Sure.
So I like to work in, I'll stay in the theater and feature filmmaking and also opera. I've done a lot of operas, and I'll
Magic Flute you did?
I did Magic Flute. I'm going to, for Zubin Mehta. I did Salome
yeah.
for Valery Gergiev at the Kirov in St. Yeah. Petersburg. Flying Dutchman will be in Houston in the fall, and I did it in L.A. about two summers ago. And Oedipus Rex I did with Jesse Norman.
But it doesn't get any better than it is right now for you.
In this medium, definitely not. And with the response, I don't yeah. think so. No, I'm having a ball. It's been a terrific reaction and experience.
Julie Taymor, thank you, thank you, thank you. It was a wonderful experience to see and to feel, and I know that I simply mirror what everybody else is saying. A couple of things that are important, because in the context of what we've said, this is about 20 years of theater work, right?
Yeah, here,
so
here and there.
If you want to know more about this, some of the things we talked about, here is the CD, The Lion King, and also there is coming out
Pride Rock on Broadway.
On Broadway.
The Making of the Lion King, a book that was written during the process.
We'll be right back. Don't go away.